Hello and welcome all. Today is going to be a most exciting session because we have been talking in this course about medical model, medical humanities, Hippocratic oath, clinical aspects of disability, schizophrenia, quite a lot of things. But we never had an opportunity to explore medicine from its core. For that reason, we have here Dr. Satendra. Dr. Satendra is a real doctor, he's a medic. He's not an academic. Well, he's an academic too. But more importantly, he identifies himself as a disabled. He's a wheelchair user. There may be good many doctors who have disabilities, but they don't necessarily identify and want to reform medicine from inside. So we have such a person. Welcome Dr. Satendra on board.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kara.
It'll be great if you can introduce yourself and then we can go on from there. Satin.
Yeah. Hello everyone. So I am Dr. Satendra Singh. I am Associate Professor of Physiology at University College of Medical Sciences, which is the constituent medical college of University of Delhi. I am also founder of medical humanities group at my medical institution. And I am also a person with a locomotor disability.
Great. Satin, what do people mean by medical education? We know it's teaching and learning about medicine, but what is it that fascinates discussion about it everywhere?
Well, in India, we have the maximum number of medical schools in the country. There is around, in fact, in the globe, we have around 512 medical colleges in the country, which is a very huge number. So medical education is the training part where we teach undergraduate medical students and the postgraduate medical students into healthcare. And considering the status of the geographical status of the India, we already have a very skewed doctor and patient ratio. So this is the whole aspect of the healthcare, and when we talk specifically about medical education, it is the training of the undergraduate or the postgraduate students towards becoming a complete human doctor. So it entails both MBBS as the entry level and then MDMS at the second level, and the third level is the super specialization.
And what are the components of normal medical training?
So the normal medical training is around 4.5 years of medical education, which we call as undergraduate medical education or MBBS in India, Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Science. So it is 4.5 years, and then it is followed by a mandatory 1 year internship. After that, the candidate becomes a certified medical doctor or medical graduate. He can have his own practice, or if he wants to further a career in other specialty, then he can go for post graduations. So for an Indian medical graduate, or we can say an MBBS doctor, the typical period is 5.5 years.
So basically, one studies intensively and learns how to do surgical procedures and learns about various aspects of medicine, and then one has a year to have a hands-on experience with hospital life, patients, and so on. So is this what it means?
Yeah, actually, if I give you a more detail about this whole 5.5 year MBBS curriculum, it is structured into 3 professional years. The first professional is about preclinical subjects, which includes anatomy, physiology, and biochemistry. It consists of 2 semesters, and after that we have paraclinical subjects in which we have pathology, microbiology, community medicine and pharmacology and forensic medicine. And finally, we have clinical subjects in which we have the traditional clinical subjects like surgery, medicine, gynae and ops, pediatrics, ENT, ophtha, and these specialties. And from second year onwards, the students, they try to go to the clinics. So they have the patient interaction from the second year onwards. However, now Medical Council of India, they have restructured the whole curriculum. So after a very long delay of 22 years, from this year onwards, from August 2019, there will be a new competency-based medical education curriculum, which focuses on early clinical exposure, so that students who want to become doctor, they don't have to wait for one long year to interact with the patient.
So there is this something called competency now in place, and what does that mean, Sathya?
The competency basically means that what are the abilities and attributes which are expected of a doctor. So these are the various traits, the minimum traits which are expected of an Indian medical graduate or an MBBS doctor. So now there is a shift in the teaching style in the medical curriculum. It is now outcome based. So we are now looking at what are the minimum competencies or what are the minimum attributes which an MBBS doctor must have. So they will be evaluated on those competencies, those outcomes. So this is a new curriculum which we're talking about.
In some sense, before this hospitalization, corporatization and most importance given to hospital ways of doing things, people always learned medicine through some kind of apprenticeship, meaning hands-on approach to healing, treatment and so on. Is this going back to the original ways of doing it, or is it any different?
In some ways, it will be similar to what you mentioned, which is shadowing a physician. If you look at the entry level of a student into MBBS in India, at the age of 17 to 19, they apply for medicine. So in India, what is happening is that a student is getting into MBBS without having, experience, without having exploring the other streams. On the contrary, if we compare it with US or UK, there after 12th class, they undergo graduations. So they have a grounding in various subjects, be it, medicine, be it arts or humanities or social sciences or engineering. And then they decide if they still want to pursue a career in healthcare or medicine. So here, in contrast, in India, the students are entering into a medical field at a very young age of 19 years of age, when they have not even explored the whole world. So that is the basic difference between the US and the Indian system of entry of a student into a medical profession. Secondly, again, at the entry level, in the NEET examinations, which gives entry to the candidates into the medical field, it is entirely an MCQ-based entrance examinations. It only tests your cognitive abilities. It does not test your analytical skills or abilities, whether you are cut for this field, which is very highly competitive, and whether or not you have those analytical abilities or not. So we are not checking any behavioral aspect into this one, I think, which is a big, policy lacuna in our system. We are only testing people on the basis of their cognitive levels. But when they enter into a course, which is 4.5 years of MBBS, followed by internship, and if you add to that 3 years of post-graduation and 2 years of super specialization, it is a very long course.
Yes.
So we are not even touching that aspect of, whether they are up for it as per their mental abilities are concerned or not.
And also, I think this has to do with our larger environment. None of us are asked or made to think or allowed to think whether we are...
Yeah, that is one thing. And the second is, I think, the patriarchal attitude in India. The children, they are treated like children. Even when they are 19 plus, even the teachers, they say them bachas and children. They do not consider them as an adult. And then at this age, they do not have any choice. If your parent has your hospital and it is inadvertently thought that you will become a doctor and take care of the hospital. Even if you have an aptitude for, say, music or, say, for other things, people never ask you. So I think this is a typical mindset, the patriarchal attitude which is there in our society.
Well, 100 years ago, Mr. Flexner submitted a report in America saying that medical schools have very low output in terms of quality, and they are just producing students who just know something about anatomy, biochemistry and surgery, but they are not producing fuller, wholesome doctors. 100 years later, the Flexner report was in 2010, I think it was revisited to take stock of medical school curriculum, medical schools' engagement with human conditions, which involved ethics and much more. Where are we? How much have we traveled from there in general and India in particular, Satya?
Yeah, well, there was a landmark report, Alexander Flexner, when he gave that landmark report, the Flexner report. It brings out a lot of reform in the curricular structure in US and Canada medical schools. For the very first time, they questioned, you know, the status quo over there. And that brings a series of reforms in their curriculum. And that is the reason if you compare that with, you know, Indian medical schools, for example, even after 100 years of Flexner report in UK, still they questioned even Flexner 100 years ago. He said that, you know, the medical school should not be only place for the riches, and they should also open doors for those who are poor or those who are from the marginalized communities. So they talked about it subtly about, you know, the social responsibility or the social accountability of the medical institutions. So based on that, the schools in US, they were reformed, they changed their structure. Initially, it was a typical, you know, compartmentalized medical education. For example, for the 2 years, we talked about the subjects like, you know, anatomy, biochemistry and physiology, but we did not cover the clinical aspects. It was more of a theoretical stuff. So when we are talking about medicine, we need to talk about clinical medicine right from the day one. So those things happen after Flexner reforms in US. In UK also now they are talking about diversity and inclusion, how they can open doors for those people who are from the marginalized background or racial politics, people from the, you know, the minority background. In India, we are still not, you know, up to that particular level. With the advent of this new competency-based education curriculum, still there are a few changes which are there. And probably we hope that now the time has come in India at least that, you know, we will be teaching our students about a complete holistic approach and how to deal a person and treat a person as a person and not, as Michael Foucault calls, as a typical case or an OPD number or a, you know, a patient number, this and that.
So that makes us move to the idea that patient care should be at the heart of medicine, medical training, and not machines, deeper understanding of the body, and so on, and clinical examples. Patient care should be prioritized rather than otherwise. Is that right, Satyan?
Yeah, definitely, because initially the focus was, even in India and many parts of the country, we still feel that, you know, doctor is a god, which is not so. We are just human beings which are doing our duty.
Mm.
But still, in the cultural context is such that we are treated like, you know, superhumans or gods. And patients, more or less, I mean, they are considered as someone who has no autonomy. They cannot take their own decisions. And in many parts of the country, it is very common that, you know, the decision of the women patients, they are taken by either their husband or someone who is in the family. A male usually takes a decision. So we do not give that autonomy or that respect to the patient who is there. It is very surprising because medical schools or, you know, hospitals, they are the places where patients come.
Mm.
Our existence as a medical doctor or a healthcare professional is only because, you know, patients comes to our doors. We are what we are only because of patients. That is why there is now this shift towards, you know, patient-centered medical education. Patient should be at the heart of all decisions. Whatever decisions we are taking, we need to take into consideration, you know, the choices of the patients, the wishes of the patients, and what does he want. We do not want to impose our thoughts on the patient.
What does that practically mean, Satyen, in terms of training a young person to become a doctor, in terms of practice, and in terms of curricular reform? I'm asking three different things. Maybe you can address one by one. So that'll be very useful for the listeners here.
Yeah, the first thing if I talk about is the, you know, the curricular reforms. So if we typically see the structure in the medical schools or medical colleges in the country, or elsewhere also in the, you know, the typical schools or colleges in the India, the typical culture is that, you know, the teachers, they are considered as experts. So there is this model which we call as sage on the stage. The teacher thinks that he knows everything about the subject. And the audience which is there, they are students. They have no choice, they have no wisdom, and they have no opinion. A teacher comes into the class, comes and gives a lecture and goes away. So he treats, you know, the audience just like, you know, empty closed minds. He comes with an information. There is an information overload which is transmitted to the closed brains, and that's the end of it. On the contrary, now there is a shift. Now this was initially, you know, criticized by an educationist, Paulo Freire, who gave the theory of oppressed.
Correct.
He wrote the book Pedagogy of the Oppressed.
Correct.
So he talked about this banking model of education, which is the same one that, you know, we think that there is a, there is an oppression because we think that we are the experts, and the people who are there, they're not experts. This is again a violation of the adult learning principles. The audience who are there, they are no more children to whom you can dictate. Now they are adult people, they know about what their goals are, what they want to do, and we need to involve them in this teaching learning methodologies. So now there is a shift that from sage to sage on stage, we are moving towards, you know, guide on site. Nowadays we don't talk about teachers, we usually say that they are facilitators.
Okay.
We now give the students who are there in the audience, we consider them as an equal partner in this learning. And both of us learn in this exchange, both the teacher and the students. So we are basically facilitators. We nowadays, their culture is that we are using problem-based questions in our curriculum, specifically because we are dealing with the patients who can have lots of signs and symptoms. So we need to arrive at the correct diagnosis. So in this scenario, we do not want an MCQ approach because that is not suitable. In this, what we need is that the doctor needs to know, have a critical, you know, analytical attitude, so that he can arrive at the diagnosis considering the signs and symptoms, which will vary from place to place. There are different terminologies in different states. There are very common lingo used in, you know, Hindi languages, which patients often, you know, use when they are saying that they are having this particular illness. And you won't find those terminologies in the medical curriculum.
Yeah.
They will define the character of their pain as different ways that we are feeling hararat, we are feeling uchati and things like that, which are part of the normal, you know, lingo, which is not there in other in the English, or no, it is not there in the curriculum.
Correct.
So that way we need to understand that and we need to know that. So that is why the role, which is very important as far as training a medical student is concerned, is that we need to understand about the experiencing learning ways. And that is why I think there is a greater role of medical humanities. Currently, the problem with the medical education is that it is heavily based on, now we move on to disability studies, it is heavily based on the medical model of disability.
Right.
That is the flip side of medicine, and it actually, you know, changed my mindset also. As I shared with you that I am a person with locomotor disability. So till I completed my 12th, I was totally ignorant. Not exactly ignorant, I think I would say that I never embraced disability as part of my life or part of my existence.
Yes.
I only said, you know, this is sort of an, you know, thodi si problem hai, yeah, there's
yeah,
some
yeah.
sort of a disability yeah. thing of that.
Kind of a nuisance to get rid of, I mean, to
Absolutely.
Overcome.
And when I entered into the medical college at GSV Medical College, Kanpur, a government medical college, in the 5.5 years of the curriculum, when I read about medicine, they re-established or re-instituted this notion that, you know, I am the problem. So this is what the medical model of disability says, that you have a problem, let's fix it.
Let's fix it.
And when I went to my medical schools, again, I realized that, when I have to, you know, when I was in clinics and I have to come back to the 12-to-1 lecture, my hospital was on the other side of the road. My medical college was on the other side of the road. So it needs to take some time. So I was the one usually, and apart from me, there was one of my colleague who was having, she was having this Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. So the two of us, we were the, you know, people who used to enter the classroom, you know, 30 minutes after the classes started. And that time we cursed ourselves that our disability is our problem. And because in nowhere in the curriculum, we were never told about the social model of disability. So this was in a way a sort of, you know, what you call as internalized stigma or internalized discrimination.
Correct.
This thought process was, you know, deeply ingrained into my psyche that I am the part of the problem. The things only changed when I came to Delhi and I finished my MD and joined here as a faculty in the University College of Medical Sciences. And when I faced discrimination for the first time, that was the time when I read the older PWD Act of 1995. I read about the United Nations Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. And then I came to know that people only have impairments. For example, I am having a physical impairment.
Correct.
Those who are blind, they are having visual impairments. Those who are deaf, they are having hearing impairments. It's the society which makes us disabled by their barriers. And what are these barriers? These barriers are, if there is no ramp, I, having an impairment of polio, I will become a disabled. If there are no braille formats or no, you know, web accessibility, a blind person will become disabled. If there are no sign language interpreters, a hearing impaired will become disabled.
Correct.
So that was an Eureka's moment for me, an eye-opener for me. And then I realized that what are we doing? We are teaching the future doctors that you are the part of the problem, that disability is a problem. And that's why, you know, it was very strange for me that, you know, it only took a world report, the World Health Organization's 2011 World Report on Disability, which very clearly in black and white stated that, you know, physicians globally, they lack on how to deal with patients with disabilities. They are never not taught about that. The reason why they are not taught about disability is that, you know, the syllabus or the curriculum of MBBS is very huge and vast.
Yes.
There are so many diseases. And what we are producing is our global doctors. We are teaching you into medicine. You can come, remain in India. You can go to US. You can go to UK, anywhere. You might find TB, tuberculosis, highly prevalent in India. Leprosy, very common in India. But when you go to US, cystic fibrosis will be very common.
Correct.
You cannot say, there is no excuse that you don't know about these conditions. So there is a problem that the course is so vast, and still we are teaching that vast course. We are teaching all these disabilities as per the medical model of disability. So I think the time has now come where we need to include disability studies into the medical curriculum. I gave you my personal example that I completed my MBBS. I did my MD. Until then, despite being a person with a disability, despite having lived experience of disability, I never thought that, you know, there is, I only have an impairment, and you know the barriers exist in the environment or in the atmosphere. So imagine, what about those people who are non-disabled? How they will learn from these things that, you know, we need to view disability as a human rights model and not as a medical model of disability.
Well, very nice. Thank you, Satyen. The thing is, now you're talking about disability. At the same time, you're also talking about the challenges in bringing a comprehensive curriculum, which include labels, clinical jargons, issues, themes connected to human, several human condition. Maybe a mid path could be to teach how the budding doctors about the art of listening. Maybe because the art of listening entails not only to listen to what patients say, but also listen beneath the lines, between the lines about what they say. Oh, That kind of approach may enable doctors to see the points that you're raising, the difference between impairment and disability, disability aware medical training, and so on. Do you agree with me, Satyen?
I completely agree with you. But the problem is that, you know, when in India, the problem is that the students join MBBS at a very young age. So they are still exploring, you know, the life. Now, what happens is that when they are in 11th or 12th, they are looking for competitive examinations, how to clear MBBS entrance examinations. So their focus is typically on the MCQ examinations. And they join MBBS, then again, their focus is, you know, how to pass examinations or think about the postgraduate examinations. What is happening in this phase is that because I interact with the students when they come into the medical college on the very first day, when you listen to them, they have very high hopes.
Yeah.
They want to serve the society.
Mm.
They are very, they have very noble intentions.
Mm.
We want to change the, you know, the things. We want to help the needy and the poor. We want to do specialization. We want to bridge the, you know, the gap between the healthcare and the lack of doctors and things like that. But unfortunately, after some times, after 1 or 2 years, when they pass out, we have done this longitudinal study
mm.
on the empathy decline in the medical students. We have used the empathy questionnaire on them.
Mm.
And we have found that there is an empathy decline in the medical students of the same batch, right from, you know, first clinical year, first MBBS year to the final year.
Why does that happen, Satyen?
So why happens? This is the reason why, because, you know, there is this cynicism comes and there is a, this empathy decline comes. They are very empathetic in the first year and then they suddenly become, you know, robotic when they are doing their internship.
Hmm.
The amount of patient overload which they normally see in the internship
hmm.
and the amount of patients which come to the OPD outpatient departments in the government hospitals, we have very long queues.
Wow.
And we, though we say that, you know, in every day in OPD, we see around 100 patients.
Mm.
We hope that, you know, there is a scope for the art of listening. But if you look at the logistics,
mm.
usually a doctor is hardly getting 2 to 3 minutes to see a patient.
Mm.
And what is happening in the tertiary care hospitals, because my hospital is a tertiary care hospital. In my OPD, if there is a doctor who is their physician, he's also seeing the, you know, cases of people who are having sneezing or cough, mild cold.
Mm.
And he's also seeing a patient who is having a renal failure. Now, the problem is, look at this, you know, a disparity that people who can be treated at the primary health care center, they're also coming to the tertiary care hospital. So where is the time for doctors to understand this art of listening? Moreover, there is a very important point, you know, art of listening also comes from the verbal and non-verbal behavior.
Correct.
Communication skills, a very important part of communication skills is the non-verbal things.
Mm.
When you are sitting here in your OPDs and you are, how you are interacting with the patient, can you gauge from his, the way he's entering into the, into your clinic about, can you diagnose his gait or how he's feeling about that?
Mm-hmm.
So these are very important things and these only come from when you, you know, train your doctors in these things. Because if I give you an example, there was a patient who went to the gynae OPD. She was pregnant and she had gone there for antenatal checkup.
Mm.
She was accompanied by her brother-in-law.
Mm.
She was a blind lady.
Mm.
And the gynecologist, you know, she did the examinations. And after doing the examinations, per-vaginal examinations,
mm.
rather than saying those findings to the blind lady,
mm.
she told these findings to the brother-in-law. And that mm. time the lady shouted, "The doctor, I am blind, and I'm not deaf. I can listen."
Mm.
This is, this example will highlight.
I can relate happening. To this episode as yet another blind person.
Yeah.
The doctors talk to the person who comes with me.
Not yeah, the me. Reason is that many yeah. times the doctors, they want to help the patients.
Mm.
But the problem is that even in their 5 years of MBBS,
mm.
they have never ever interacted, you know, a deaf person. They don't even know that a deaf person who comes to see you in the hospital, many of the deaf person, they can actually lip read. And the doctors mm. are not aware of that. Many a time there is a laptop between a doctor and a patient, which impedes this communication because mm. they are not aware that even deaf people can also lip read. So these are very small things, you know, which should be the part of the, you know, curriculum. That is why I'm saying that, you know, These are the very important things which needs to be there. And how do you expect a doctor to understand these things? They are not themselves a disabled person. How can they understand these things? The one of the thing is that they don't have time because the curriculum is huge. So I think the opportunity lies in narrative medicine. If they are reading the narratives of doctors as patients, doctor become patients, there are so many narratives that they become hugely empathetic.
Oh yeah, there are good many amount of them.
Good
then many.
They understand their disability. Rita Sharon has, you know, pioneered this field of narrative medicines.
Yes.
Then there are patient narratives of, you know, people with disabilities when they write about their lived experiences, for example, in a healthcare, or when there are cancer survivors. There's a recent novel, When Breath Becomes Air, of a doctor, you know, who has this, who died because of this
lung cancer.
Illness.
Yeah.
And then he wrote this, he shared his experiences. So these are the things, because the problem is that in India, when a medical student joins MBBS, he in his life has never read about literature. What is the role of literature in shaping, you know, healthcare? They cannot even think that, you know, arts has a big role in medical education. I told you about, mentioned about the communication skills. Now, one of the very important thing of your verbal and non-verbal communication is that you can hone your observation skills if you know how to interpret a painting. So arts is a medium which can hone your observation skills, and a doctor needs to have a very high observation skills. And moreover, you know, now recently the World Health Organization, they have declared burnout as an official, you know, medical disorder.
Correct.
And very often we find that, you know, medical doctors after a certain period of time, they face this burnout situation. And one of the possible way out is, you again, is medical humanities, when there is a joy for learning. When they discover this joy in writing, in reflectively sharing their experiences of their good patient or their worst patient or the challenges in healthcare. So I think our future doctors need to know about these things, that there are avenues from the social sciences which plays a very important role in improving the patient-provider relationship.
Certainly. Well, rewinding a little bit before getting into the idea of disability competence that you are working on, can you say a bit more about, they don't get training in literature, medicine, art, human experiences, communication. That is understood. I get that point. But what are the way, what is the nature of training? I mean, they should be given simulation exercises about what is a typical patient behave like, or a patient of a particular problem, say gynecology or brain disease. They should have models to think about and work on as a student. What does it involve?
No, I completely agree with you. And in fact, many of the medical colleges in India, in isolation, they are utilizing, you know, these simulation as innovation. In our medical school also, in fact, one of the thesis topic which I gave to my postgraduate student, that was because I told you that in India right now, we have a traditional curriculum where in the first two semesters or in the first year of preclinical, we do not have any interaction with patient. So I gave her the thesis topic of early clinical exposure, how you can, you know, bring an early clinical exposure by using virtual patients.
Correct.
So we created two virtual patients, which were, you know, online virtual patients. So you can log on to the system and you will find that there is a three-dimensional patient, you know, standing in front of you. And then you have to type few questions. You can ask various questions. You can take the history.
Oh, right.
And the patient will answer. And this will give you some idea, and on the basis of that, you can create your provisional diagnosis. You can ask for lab investigations, and you can propose management.
Okay.
The funny thing is that that virtual patient is very smart. So, right, if that virtual patient is, for example, you know, it is a male patient, and if the student becomes over smart and he asks, you know, about menstrual cycle, so the virtual patient will immediately say that, can't you see that I'm a male? So that way it gives you an opportunity to, because in India the problem is that there is a huge load of patients, And the strength of medical students, it is increasing. Initially in our college there were 100 students, now it has become 150, now it is going on to become 200. So teach to, you know, give the experience of simulation to all 200 candidates is very difficult.
Correct.
So I think there is a role of these virtual patients, because we created these virtual patients, so you can use them on your laptop, you can use them on your mobile, you can use it from the confines of your home. And this will give you an idea, you can take their history and you can ask wrong questions also. But definitely you will go in the wrong direction. But at the end of that, you know, you will compare your result with the ideal result and you will know that where you faltered. So this is the art of clinical reasoning, where the student learns by committing mistakes. On the contrary, in real life, on real patients, you cannot commit mistakes. So there is a huge role of simulation in medical education. For example, we are also teaching our students during those cardiac resuscitation, CPR, how to give those techniques. So we have those artificial bodies where they can do those CPR techniques and they can learn on their own. But these are costly, but not all medical colleges have
can afford things. That. Yeah.
But it needs to be there, because until and unless there is a real experience, it is futile to teach them, you know, theoretically.
So what you are saying is the simulation exercises are good, but they should not replace real clinical patient experience with patients and listening to them.
Yeah, because I'll give you another example from the disability field, because I have seen many people, they are using those blindfold exercises.
That is another simulation, yes.
On non-disabled people to give them an experience of, you know, the problem, because they ask non-disabled to sit in a wheelchair and navigate. They blindfold you and, you know, they will ask you, you go and have a cup of tea. So that is one idea to tell them, you know, that, you know, what are the problems of people who are disabled. Point taken. But there is a flip side to it. There is another school of thought who says that this is a very negative approach. There is a recent paper on that. And they have found that this is a negative approach, because the reason being, the non-disabled person, when he sits in the wheelchair or when he's blindfolded, he perceives a negative experiences. And then he thinks, oh my God, I'm so lucky that I don't have these disabilities.
I subscribe to the second school.
Yeah, so there is another school of thought, because you are giving them that experiences, which is hindering for them.
Yes.
This is another thing, because I have over the period of time learned this phenomenon that I am disabled and I am proud. I take pride in my disability, the reason being because this disability has given me the power of resilience and perseverance, which I could not got otherwise had I been a non-disabled. So these are the experiences. So definitely you can tell them about the barriers. You can tell them that if there are no ramps, then you will be in a problem when you are in a wheelchair. But when you are giving that experience that, you know, your life, you are so lucky that you are having legs or you are having eyes, I think that is a very poor way to teach simulation to these people. I don't subscribe to that school of thought.
That's true. And also, for example, living with blindness and being blind is not living in darkness.
Absolutely.
It is the idea of not missing light in some way, or connecting to light culturally in many significant ways. Both are possible.
In Mumbai, there is this guy, Partho Bhaumik. So he, trained blind people in clicking photographs.
Yes.
So he has this organization, Blind with Camera, and he has given this quote that diminished sense does not mean diminished life. And
correct.
That's absolutely correct.
Very beautifully said. So that takes us to your original contribution here in our context, disability competence in medical education. What is it, Satya?
Yeah, so I told you that, you know.
And what are the competences? What are the competences or expectation of competences this competence will add to?
Yeah, so now we have this new curriculum, and this new curriculum is usually in sync with the global practices which are out there. The competency framework is not new. It is there in US, it is there in Canada, it is there in UK also, and now in India. So broadly, we, the Medical Council of India, they have framed 5 roles of an Indian medical graduate, which means that what are the minimum which is expected from an MBBS doctor in India. So within those five domains,
what are those domains?
Those domains are that the first, you know, domain, first role is that an Indian medical graduate should be a clinician. So that means that he should have an adequate knowledge of patient medical knowledge and patient care.
Yes.
The second thing is he should be a communicator.
Mm.
So which covers, you know, both verbal and non-verbal skills. The third is that he should be a professional, which takes into consideration the role of ethics, the professional behavior. And the next is that he should be a lifelong learner, which is a very important skill for a medical doctor.
Mm.
Because the science is changing enormously. Every time we are seeing new papers that, you know, we have evidence-based medicine that this drug doesn't work, we have a new thing.
Correct.
So a doctor has to constantly engage, and he should know what are the skills by which he can become a lifelong learner.
Mm.
And the third is interprofessional education. He should also know that when he is working as a doctor, he's working in a team. So he's actually a leader of the team.
Mm.
So he should know how to communicate with the nursing professional, how to communicate with the physiotherapist, how to communicate with the patient who comes in the emergency and there is a huge crowd outside. So these are the skills, the real life skills, which are never taught, but these are very important in managing the situation, diffusing the emergency. So they should also know that they have a role as a leader also, in because now technology is replacing these things. We are talking about team-based skills. So these are the five broad roles of Indian medical graduate. So under these five roles, we have defined disability competencies.
Mm.
So how we have defined those disability competencies? The one thing was that I consider myself as an expert.
Yes.
And write down the competencies. This is the end of it.
But okay.
That is not a democratic way, because these are my personal biases.
Mm.
I am a person with locomotor disability. I do not have any lived experience of someone who is blind or deaf.
Mm.
So it is unethical on my part to be their voice.
Correct.
Without asking them.
Mm.
So the approach which we used was that we search literature and we find that many of the papers which are there in the disability competencies, they're either expert commentaries or they have interacted with the medical teachers or medical educators.
Mm.
So there was a general flaw in this approach, because they never took into consideration the real stakeholders, which
are the voice of the disabled
persons.
Yeah.
So what we did was that we identified three broad stakeholders. The first one was disability rights activists.
Mm.
So we had focus group discussions with disability rights activists.
Mm.
The second were a unique terminology, doctors with disabilities.
Yes.
We are talking about disability, we are talking about healthcare professionals. But where are the voices of doctors with disabilities? Now, I'm very happy that gradually now, even the Madras High Court recently has given a judgment where for the first time they have mentioned doctors with disabilities. Similarly, I was in the committee which framed the rules for the rights of persons with disability rules in Delhi. In that, there is again mention of the word doctors with disabilities.
Correct.
So we had FGDs with doctors with disabilities. And the third group was the medical educators. What they think are the competencies which should be there in the curriculum.
Correct.
So based on these FGDs, we interviewed them, recorded their experiences, and then we came out with 57 competencies, which were quite large. And then we shared them with the disability listservs, which are there on various groups.
Mm.
We asked for their feedback, because those FGDs were done in Delhi. It was not pan-India consultation. So we also got feedback from the other disability groups from pan-India. Based on that, we modified our competencies, reduced them to 27. So now we have these 27 competencies, which we think that any healthcare professional, be it a doctor, be it a, you know, nursing professional, or be it a physiotherapist, or be it somebody else, allied professional, they need to know when we are talking about disability.
I see. And you said you counted 27.
Yeah.
Can you walk us through some of them, Suthen, if not 27?
Yeah, we have defined them into, I told you there are five roles. For example, the first role is as a clinician.
Mm.
So during our focus group discussion, you know, this issue came out that, you know, what is the definition of disability we want our medical students to know?
Correct.
But then again, there is a huge controversy on this. We do not want to use the definition which was there in the Rights of Persons with Disabilities Act, or which is there in the Americans with Disabilities Act.
Correct.
Because these are different.
Correct.
So we used a human rights approach. We used the UNCRPD as the benchmark.
Mm.
because there was one stakeholder in our focus group interview, and he said that he is having celiac disease. Now, gluten intolerance or celiac disease is not a recognized disability in India.
Correct.
Similarly, myasthenia gravis, but these are recognized disabilities in US.
Mm.
So we do not want our medical student or future doctor to get confused between this thing. So we said that even the UNCRPD, they have shied away from defining disability. They have mentioned it is an evolving concept.
Yes.
So we have used that particular concept to talk about disability, that you don't have to learn the definition as per the RPD Act or as per the AD. But you know what is the essence in UNCRPD. That is the first thing. The second thing is the second competency is that an Indian medical graduate in India, disability certification is a huge thing.
Yes.
All the entitlements are, you know, linked to
connected
the
to
disability certification.
Correct. Correct.
So in that we have said that, you know, an Indian medical graduate must know
how to
certify a disabled person based on functional competence. Now, what is the meaning of this functional competence? I'll give you a real life example. Recently, there was a candidate, Dr. Mohammed Shalam, who has done his MBBS from Jaipur. So he became certified doctor. He came to Delhi. He did his residency in RML Hospital. And then he applied for post-graduation and he was rejected for post-graduation.
Because
the reason given was that his disability was 80%.
Yes.
And how was that calculated? Now, he is a person with locomotor disability. He uses crutches.
Correct.
The certification was that they asked him to, you know, keep his crutches on one side and try to walk. It is same as, you know, you are asking a wheelchair user to leave your wheelchair and, you know, to show how to walk. Now, in that way, his percentage will be 90%, and that's how he got 90% percentages, and MCI has a bar on 80%. So
correct.
Our logic was that a future doctor must not know about, you know, exact percentage, but he should know what is the functional competence.
Functional competence.
When you
yes.
are defining a disability certification, you need to know with the help of assistive devices whether he can carry on day-to-day activities or not. And when he challenged this in the High Court, now MCI later on amended this particular clause. And this is the same thing which is there in our competencies. Then third thing is that we have also stressed in the communication part of competencies that a doctor must know about the non-verbal communication as well as the things which are expected in the specific culture. When we say specific culture, we are giving respect to, you know, the deaf culture. So we should know that, you know, they have a different culture and they we should, you know, acknowledge their deaf culture also. Similarly, other people also from the disability sector, we need to know what are the right terminologies. For example, autistic people prefer the word autistic. Blind people, they are not averse to the word blind.
Yes.
So rather, people should know that there is a difference between person with a disability, the fancy term, and disabled person. What Michael Oliver talk about in the social model of disability and how it is criticized. So these are the things which are we want our students, they must know, and they must gather these information through tools which are grained in medical humanities, through the lived experiences, through narrative medicine, through arts, and through the history of medicine.
Wow, that's an impressive list actually. That means somewhere we are talking about a close interchange, dialogue between clinicalism, that is a deeper understanding, clinical understanding of the body and mind, and politics and culture connected with the disability. So, in some sense, a conversation between both, an awareness of both together is what is called disability competence.
Yeah, absolutely, because this is my personal experience that, you know, I was a very strong proponent of nothing about us without us.
Yes.
Before I was involved in this project, when I was involved in this project, there was an eye-opener for me, because what I learned was that during our focus group discussions that the people who were disability rights activists, they are talking about all the rights of disabled people. On the contrary, the group which were doctors with disabilities, they were not even aware of their rights. Though they were people with disabilities, they were having lived experiences. But shockingly, because they were trained in, they were trained in the medical model of disability, none of these were aware of their rights.
Mm.
So that time I revisited my thinking, I reflected on my understanding, you know, that the idea nothing about us without us is very good as an advocacy tool.
Mm.
But in policy making, I mean, imagine a situation where there is a disabled person who has absolutely zero knowledge of their rights, it will create havoc.
Yes.
So you have to need a balance between these things, and that was a huge, you know, takeaway for me from this project.
Now, where do we go from here, Satyen? So now that we have conversation in a deeper way about disability in medicine, where do we go from here?
Yeah, this is a very good question, because you know, you are asking me and am I answering you, but we are talking to, you know, people who are already converted.
Correct.
And specifically people who are joining this course because they have an interest in disability studies.
Correct.
But what we want is that we want to change the attitude and behavior of the society.
Mm.
And it is very difficult to change because it takes years and years. So that is our larger goal, how to change the attitude and behavior of those people who are not interested in disability.
Mm.
For that, if I give you the example of medical education, now fortunately we have this new curriculum.
Mm.
So there is an opportunity now because there is a scope of elective in this. Moreover, I personally believe that this disability is not something which should be taught as a elective mode. It should be in the longitudinal part of the curriculum right from day one to the final year. So for that, the new curriculum is there. So my second thing is that I'm finding what are the ways in various years in which we can introduce these things as part of the ethics training module. So I will be doing that exercise after this time. I will be identifying the gap areas where we can use these things. And I will be preparing a module specifically for medical students. So, and then we will send it to the Medical Council of India, how to use that. We have already sent our competences to the Medical Council of India. But the second part is that these are just, you know, a piece of paper competencies. We need to prepare the teaching learning methodologies to attain these competencies. We cannot give a lecture on these things. People need to visit those places. They need to interact with these people because now we have 21 disabilities. They need to go to the NGOs also, to these communities also. They need to hear their experiences also. So we will define those teaching learning methodologies. What is the best part? How we can best use disability studies into medical education curriculum?
And also in tandem with medical humanities, right? Because disability studies can and can most definitely instill disability competence in medical education and awareness of human diversity. But medical humanities can do some more, because it can, for example, you were talking about narrative medicine. So it can get in such skills into medical education and training. Is that right, Satyen?
Yes, definitely, because that is what I'm looking forward, because as I told you, we have a medical humanities group.
Yeah.
So the teaching learning methodologies which we shall be using for these will involve literature, history of medicine. There is very interesting Augusto Boal's Theatre of the Oppressed, which we use very often. Narrative medicine, the role of poetry and these things. So that this becomes a wholesome, interesting course.
Yes.
Because people who are not interested into literature, they might be interested into poetry.
Mm.
So we need to take into consideration the people's choices. So that's why we will use the tools from the medical humanities for this particular course.
Wonderful, Satyen. I think we had a very fruitful and also a comprehensive discussion on medical education in reference to disability and much more. Thank you, Satyen.
Thank you so much, Dr.
Thank you, sir.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah. Bye-bye.